is ecosystem well-being. The association of HbA1c levels with age was significant in both the genders. The Pearson correlation with the age with HbA1c levels in both the genders were highly significant and it was less than 0.05. Significant association was found between HbA1c levels and different age groups also. In males, mean HbA1c ranges from 5 to 5.3% and in females, the range is 5.76 to 6.47%. Association found was highly significant as all the p-values were less than 0.05. The figure 4 here depicts the correlation of the males and females in all the genders, in all the age groups. Figure 5 depicts the scatter plot diagram of HbA1c with age. This is an overall position of the study. Table number 1 here describes the correlation of age with HbA1c, and you can appreciate that all the values, most of the values coming out are significantly higher. Discussion. We observed that the HbA1c levels are increasing with age and was found to be lower in females. Aging process can be faster because of accumulation of toxic metabolic products. These substances could be the products of non-enzymatic glycation. The elevation of HbA1c with age was not influenced by the level of physical activity. The table 2 here, the major advanced glycated end products called as age has been described in this table. Table number 3, only several major proteins undergoing glycation has been described. Here we can see that aldehyde is being glycated, the glycated sugar is glucose, and the result outcome is increased glycation and diabetes. Rest all HbA1a, HbA1b, HbA1c, all of them are being glycated and their outcomes are as follows. The main point to note over here is that the glycation is being going on in individuals who are not in healthy individuals, whether they are diabetic or non-diabetic. But in diabetics, since the exposure of RBC to the glucose is low, the levels of HbA1c increases. To conclude, I would like to say that the results suggest that interpretation of HbA1c levels should be done in the light of age and gender, and age-related glycation may contribute to retinopathy, neuropathy, nephropathy, cardiomyopathy, and Alzheimer's disease. Thank you.
Dr. Bhavani, we would like you to come on stage.
My topic for paper is correlation between anthropometric indices and lipid profiling MMAU scheme Lana Mala. Introduction. Obesity is a worldwide health issue associated with excessive fat accumulation in the body to the extent that health and well-being are adversely affected. Obesity may increase the risk of many diseases such as diabetes, atherosclerosis, hypertension, dyslipidemia, gallbladder diseases, and cardiovascular diseases. Anthropometric measurements can easily reflect any changes in the lipid concentration in the human body. Intra-abdominal fat has been identified as being the most clinically relevant type of fat in humans. Abnormal visceral fat produce physiological changes that alter lipid profile, leading to dyslipidemia, which in turn increase the risk of cardiovascular events. Body mass index, weight and hip circumferences were found to be useful anthropometric predictors for cardiovascular risk. The aims of and objective for this study was firstly to determine and evaluate the overweight, obesity and dyslipidemia status in people of MM University. Secondly, to evaluate the correlation between lipid profile and anthropometric indices of total and central obesity. Material methods. The present study was conducted among 90 adults, in which 45 were females and 45 were males. All subjects were apparently healthy. The serum lipid profile included total cholesterol, high density lipoprotein, low density lipoprotein, and triglycerols. Triglycerols HDL was estimated by Trindle and methods, whereas total cholesterol is estimated by CHOT CAP kinetic methods. The low density lipoprotein was calculated by Fragments method, whereas the body weight was measured in kilograms by a mechanical scale to the nearest kilograms. Height was measured to the nearest 1 centimeter with a ball mounted stereometer. whereas body mass index was calculated by Quetelet's index. Adults were classified according to their BMI into three groups. The range of the normal BMI was taken less than 22.9 kg per meter square, whereas the BMI range between 23 to 24.9 kg per meter square was taken as overweight, as well as greater than 25 kg per meter square was taken as obese. The waist and hip circumference was measured with its flexibility. The waist hip ratio equals hip circumference divided by hip circumference. The exclusion criteria for this study was pregnant females, hypertensive, diabetic patients, cardiac patients. We can see here the average age of males was 40 years and females were 36 years. On the basis of BMI, we found that there was 14.44% of normal weight person, 26.67% of overweight, and 58.89% was obese. Abnormal levels of triglycerides in 35, total cholesterol in 20, low density lipoprotein in 3, whereas LDL in 27 of total sample were found. Overall correlation was found between anthropometric analysis and lipid profile. Triglyceride was found correlated with waist circumference, whereas waist hip ratio was correlated with triglyceride in total cholesterol. Statistically significant p-value was found among normal and abnormal values on all the parameters. This is the graph showing the classification of BMI according to the gender. Here we can see that the total number of obese person was found to be higher. The table number one shows the Pearson correlation and the anthropometric analysis and lipid profile parameters. In this case, we can appreciate that this circumference was found related to triglyceride and VLDL, and the weight ratio was related to TG, whereas TC and as well as VLDL. But in this study, BMI did not correlate with any of the lipid profile parameters. Table 2, in this table we divide all the anthropometric parameters into normal and abnormal values. Independent t-test was done, and we found that all the p-values were on normal and abnormal lines were found significantly, very highly significant. In this table, we divide the all lipid profile parameters in normal and abnormal values. Here also, all the p-values were statistically significant. This is the depiction of normal and enhanced lipid profile parameters. Here we can appreciate the D-range value of LDL was found very lower levels, and the D-range parameters of total cholesterol were found very high there. Discussion on the most common problems related to the lifestyle today is being overweight. Severe overweight or obesity is a key risk factor in the development of many chronic diseases such as heart and respiratory disease and type 2 diabetes. Abdominal fat has been associated with insulin resistance, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, certain types of cancer and osteoporosis. The third annual health and nutrition study conducted by the Korean Institute of Health and Welfare in 2001 announced that the overall prevalence of obesity in Korean adults was 13.6%. Mean value of BMI reported in the present study was 27.31 in 0.1 square. This is similar to data derived from migraine syndrome to the US. The data of Monica presents shows the prevalence of obesity in the most European countries has increased by about 10 to 40% in the past 10 years, ranging from 10 to 20% in men and 20 to 25% in women. BMI has been widely used as an indicator of total adiposity. Its limitations are clearly recognized by its dependence on weight and age. The proportion of adults was increased. Low density lipoprotein C levels were negligible. Lower prevalence has been found in the diet. Coming to the conclusion, we found a good correlation between anthropometric analysis of gender and central obesity and lipid profile. Among the anthropometric analysis, WHO could be a good predictor of dyslipidemia, showing the importance of using in clinical practice or screening of cardiovascular. Prospective studies using different parameters to assess abdominal obesity and its relationship
तो मेटाबॉलिक प्रोफाइल में जो लार्जर पॉपुलेशन और नीचे जो 2500 ऑफ एप्लीकेशन टू कम्युनिटी हेल्थ लाइफ स्टाइल कम्युनिटी.
नाउ आई
इनवाइट
डॉक्टर सुमित, प्लीज कम ऑन द स्टेज एंड प्रेजेंट.
Today our discussion of the topic is a prospective randomized open label study comparing efficacy and tolerability of amlodipine and ranibizumab in patients of stage 1 hypertension. According to JNC, that is Joint National Committee, the hypertension is defined as an elevated average BP on at least two office visits with at least two standardized measures of BP made at each visit. According to classification, what is normal blood pressure? That is systolic less than 120, diastolic less than 80, pre-hypertension systolic 120 to 139, diastolic 80 to 89. What is stage 1 hypertension? Stage 1 hypertension systolic 140 to 159, diastolic 90 to 99. Stage 2 hypertension more than 160 or equal to or diastolic more than equal to 100. What is isolated systolic hypertension? That is more than 140 and less than 90 diastolic. Today, what is the aim of our study? To compare the efficacy and tolerability of amlodipine and ranibizumab in patients of stage 1 hypertension. That are prospective, comparative, randomized and 12-week studies. What are inclusion criteria? Patients of either sex suffering from stage 1 hypertension whose systolic blood pressure is 140 to 159 and diastolic blood pressure 90 to 99 as per JNC 7, that is Joint National Committee. Patients between the ages of 18 years and 70 years, patients who have never been initiated on any antihypertensive drugs in the past or have given written informed consent to be part of this study. What are exclusion criteria? There are patients aged more than 70 years, history of myocardial infarction, stroke, angina, or that are taken place in within 6 months. Symptomatic CHF or ejection fraction less than 35%. Non renal insufficiency, that is creatinine more than 2 mg per deciliter, or left ventricle failure, COPD, or bronchial asthma. Requiring diuretics, CCB that are calcium channel blockers, ACE inhibitors or alpha blockers for reason other than hypertension, pregnant and lactating females, drug allergy, alcoholics, patients who cannot give written consent. What are our results? We had made two groups. In A group we had given amlodipine, and in group B we had given ranibizumab. And then after that we have taken the baseline in supine position, that is systolic blood pressure 153, and at the week 12 we have taken the reading, that is 131, that is systolic blood pressure, and standing systolic blood pressure 152, and at the end of the week 12 that is 130, and diastolic blood pressure in supine position that is 93, and week 12 80. Standing 93 and week 12 80. And in group B we have given ranibizumab. Then after that we have taken the readings. Systolic blood pressure in supine patient from 154 to it reduced to at the week of 12 that is 133. In standing position baseline was 154, at the week 12 that is 133. In diastolic in spine position that it reduced from 95 to 80, and in standing 95 from 80. Some of the adverse effects of amlodipine and ranibizumab are in CNS group A, that is amlodipine, 8% have headache, 4% have ankle edema. No hypertension, no nausea, no dry cough in amlodipine. In ranibizumab, there is 4% of headache, ankle edema, no ankle edema, 4% have hypotension, 4% of nausea, and 4% of dry cough. What is the discussion? In the present study, both groups showed significant reduction in BP from baseline to 12 weeks mean supine systolic blood pressure was reduced from 153 to 131 and 154 to 133 after 12-week treatment. The difference in mean supine and standing in group A was not statistically significant. The difference in mean supine and standing in group B was not statistically significant. No statistical significant change in heart rate and biochemical parameters has observed with both treatment groups. Conclusion that if both amlodipine and ranitidine are effective antihypertensive agents, both the drugs were equally well tolerated.